chapter 13. You have to bear with me a little bit tonight. I feel a little underprepared for this one. And I always feel underprepared, but this one a little more so. I wrote this message some years back, and I don't think I've ever preached it here. If you've heard it, just tell me later. But I don't think I preached it here, and it's not original with me as far as the idea of the message. I mean, I wrote it, but you might have heard a similar message in years gone by from different preachers, but it's God's Word, and I was thinking, I wonder how applicable this is going to be to the group that we have, but I think that to me it applies more to older grade school children up into teenage years, but the truth is we can all learn from it, and some of us in here are parents, so it can be a help to us as we try to guard children, grandchildren, whatever it may be, we can, and even ourselves, we need reminded about having proper friends. So we're going to read 2 Samuel 13, read several verses here. It's a story, a sad story really, and a story that really could have had a different outcome if Amnon would have made a better choice in friends. So beginning in verse 1, we'll read down to verse 22. And it came to pass after this that Absalom, the son of David, had a fair sister whose name was Tamar. And Amnon, the son of David, loved her. And Amnon was so vexed that he fell sick for his sister Tamar, for she was a virgin. And Amnon thought it hard for him to do anything to her. But Amnon had a friend whose name was Jonadab, the son of Shimeah, Jake David's brother. And Jonadab was a very subtle man. And he said unto him, Why art thou, being the king's son, lean from day to day? Wilt thou not tell me? And Amnon said unto him, I love Tamar, my brother Absalom's sister. And Jonadab said unto him, Lay thee down on thy bed and make thyself sick. And when thy father cometh to see thee, say unto him, I pray thee, let my sister Tamar come and give me meat, and dress the meat in my sight, that I may see it, and eat it at her hand. So Amnon lay down and made himself sick. And when the king was come to see him, Amnon said unto the king, I pray thee, let Tamar, my sister, come, and make me a couple of cakes in my sight, that I may eat at her hand. Then David sent home to Tamar, saying, Go now to thy brother Amnon's house, and dress in meat. So Tamar went to her brother Amnon's house, and he was laid down, and she took flour, and kneaded it, and made cakes in his sight, and did bake the cakes. And she took a pan, and poured them out before him, but he refused to eat. And Amnon said, Have out all men from me. And he went out every man from him. And Amnon said unto Tamar, Bring the meat into the chamber, that I may eat at thine hand. And Tamar took the cakes which she had made, and brought them into the chamber to Amnon her brother. And when she had brought them unto him to eat, he took hold of her, and said unto her, Come lie with me, my sister. And she answered him, Nay, my brother, do not force me, for no such thing ought to be done in Israel. Do not vow this folly. And I, whither shall I cause my shame to go? And as for thee, thou shalt be as one of the fools in Israel. Now therefore I pray thee, speak unto the king, for he will not withhold me from thee. Howbeit he would not hearken unto her voice, but being stronger than she, forced her and lay with her. Then Amnon hated her exceedingly, so that the hatred wherewith he hated her was greater than the love wherewith he had loved her. And Amnon said unto her, Arise, be gone. And she said unto him, There is no cause. This evil in sending me away is greater than the other that thou didst unto me. But he would not hearken unto her. Then he called his servant that ministered unto him, and said, Put now this woman out from me, and bolt the door after her. And she had a garment of divers colors upon her, for with such robes were the king's daughters that were virgins apparelled. Then his servant brought her out, and bolted the door after her. And Tamar put ashes on her head, and rent her garment of divers colors that was on her, and laid her hand on her head, and went on crying. And Absalom her brother said unto her, Had Amnon thy brother been with thee? But hold now thy peace, my sister. He is thy brother. Regard not this thing. So Tamar remained desolate in her brother Amnon's house. But when King David heard of all these things, he was very wroth. And Absalom spake unto his brother Amnon neither good nor bad. For Absalom hated Amnon because he had forced his sister. order for us to enjoy the fellowship of others. Man was not meant to live as a hermit. He wasn't meant to live by himself and his entire life. He was made to have fellowship. But who we choose as our friends will have great influence on our Christian lives. And we see in this story of Amnon and Tamar a serious importance of choosing the right friends. The Bible says that Amnon thought it hard for him to do anything to Tamar. So you have Amnon, who is a son of King David. You have Absalom, who is a son of King David. You have Tamar, who is a daughter of King David, but they're half-sisters. Amnon and Tamar are half-sisters. Tamar is Amnon's half-sister, same father, different mothers, and Amnon's just burned it with lust towards his sister, and his conscience is stopping him. He wants his sister, but at the same time, he knows it's not right. He knows it's wrong, and he's got this sinful tendency, but man, it's just, I can't bring myself to do this. And it says, the Bible says he thought it hard for him to do anything to Tamar. And since this is true, which you know the Bible is, it's true that he thought it hard, something had to have changed in Amnon's life in order for him to commit such a sin as taking advantage of his sister. What changed Amnon's mind concerning this matter? The answer is in verse 3. These first few words in verse 3. The end of verse 2 says he thought it hard for him to do anything to her. And then there's this little word, but. And it says Amnon had a friend. And his friend's name was Jonadab, who also happened to be his first cousin. So he's family as well. He's not just a friend, he's family. See that Jonadab was the catalyst in this story that made such a drastic change in the life of Amnon. Now, don't get me wrong here. Amnon was not innocent in this story. But the focus I'd like to focus on is the influence of friends in our lives. We're going to see four things that Jonadab's influence brought into Amnon's life tonight. And the first we see in verses 5 through 11, Jonadab said to him, lay me down on thy bed and make thyself sick. He's not sick. He's making it up. He's faking it. Jonadab says, well, you know, you want your sister. What's bothering you? And Amnon says, I love my sister Tamar. Well, just do this. Just fake that you're sick. He says, go fake that you're sick. And then ask King David to send Tamar in, and then you got her right there in the room with you, and just do whatever you want from there. So the first thing we see that he introduces or influences Amnon to be is deceitful. He encourages deceit in Amnon's life, and this is dishonest. He starts off as just, he's not sick. He's making things up. He's dishonest. Types of deceit that wrong friends can bring into your life are gossip, telling embellished stories, flattery, lying. And again, you guys are going to have to bear with me as far as application tonight. Think of, I wrote this thinking of teenagers, children, older children. So if I'm referencing teenagers or children or making it sound like you, just help me with the parents. Encourage your children in this way. Parents, watch out for your children in this way. But especially when it comes to guy-girl relationships, and it should be within any relationship, but more importantly, as children get older and seek a mate for their life, if you got someone interested in your son or daughter who likes to fake things for the purpose of getting attention, you got a problem there. It's dangerous. It's scary. And sadly, we see this with bus kids, and I think a lot of times it is children just want attention because they don't get it at home. They do not get the love that they need fakes things to gain attention, it's scary. All right, so he's making this up. Amnon's making this story up just for the purpose of getting what he wants. And deceit is the start here. There's an illustration, there's a story of Abraham Lincoln. And don't know the entire background, but he was having a discussion with somebody or a dispute. And it says, when the stubborn disputer seemed unconvinced, Lincoln said, "Well, let's see, how many legs has a cow?" And the reply was kind of disgusting. He says, "Four, of course." And Lincoln says, "Well, that's right. Now, suppose you call the cow's tail a leg. How many legs would the cow have?" He says, "Well, five, of course." And Lincoln says, "Now, that's where you're wrong, because calling the cow's tail a leg does not make it a leg." And deceiving ourselves, deceiving others, it doesn't change the truth. It doesn't change the facts of God's word. It does no good, and it's destructive in our lives. So deception is the first thing that Amnon encouraged, or Jonadab encouraged Amnon to do, to let into his life. Turn to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians 4, verse 14. "That we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, and carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men, and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie and wait to deceive." Deception. This could be co-workers. This could be employers, depending on our situation. This could be anybody, a neighbor who casts doubt on God's word, a neighbor who, or a friend, a family member, whoever it may be in our lives. Deception can creep in. If they are starting to ask questions that would lead you to doubt the Bible, doubt Christianity, we've got to be careful about deception in our lives. There's some very slick people out there, subtle, as Jonadab is described here, subtle people. And Satan uses people. Satan uses friends and family to draw us away. And it might not be entirely. It might not be that we ever abandon the faith entirely, but to drop a standard here or there. And deception is the first danger that we see here, the first sin, really, that Jonadab encourages in Amnon's life. The second, we see in verses 11 through 14, and it says, "And when she had brought them unto him to eat, he took hold of her and said unto her, Come, lie with me, my sister. And she answered him, Nay, my brother, do not force me, for no such thing ought to be done in Israel. Do not thou this folly." She's saying, stop. You don't want to do this. What am I going to do with my shame? You're going to be with one of the fools in Israel, she says. She's trying to stop him. He doesn't listen. He doesn't care. He's burned with lust. And the second thing we see is not only deception, but defilement. And Jonadab's influence went even further than deception. It's interesting that when you read what Jonadab told Amnon, he never mentions exactly what. He just says, "Lay down and make yourself sick." But he knows exactly what he's doing. He knows exactly that what Amnon has in mind. He knows exactly how to manipulate. He's just planting that seed and says, just do this. This is how you can get her alone with you. He plants that seed, and then Amnon's sin, his desire, takes it from there. We see Amnon allowed Jonadab to influence him to the point of believing that what he did wasn't too bad. First, he thought it was really hard. He thought, "Can't do this. This isn't right. It's wrong. No. And then he says, "Well, just do this." Jonadab pushes him over the edge a little bit. And then Amnon thinks, "Doesn't sound so bad. I mean, he made it sound so simple. He made it sound so innocent. This is part of the deceit." And now Amnon believes it's not such a terrible sin, and he rapes his half-sister. Jonadab's influence is seen in his life, but consequences, but it's because of Jonadab's influence. Immorality is very rampant in today's society. It is literally everywhere. It is normal. It is expected. It is taught. It is strange if you think it's wrong. Parents encourage their children to be immoral. They get excited when, you know, their daughter comes home and tells them that they're expecting when they're not married. They get on, you know, social media and rave about it. It was sad. We had a girl a while back, or a girl that we picked up on the bus in Iowa, and my sister sent me a picture of something a while back, an announcement that she was expecting, 17 years old. And it's just so sad because you pour your life, your heart into these kids in hopes that they'll, you know, grab a hold of something. And her mom's all excited for it. She's all excited for it. Her friends are all excited for it. It's wrong. It's wrong according to the Bible. It's everywhere in our world. And it's a temptation to, especially as a teenager, especially as a young adult, if you're unmarried, it's a temptation when the world just flaunts it to give in. You start to think, well, is purity that necessary? Is it really that important to God? Yes, it is. It's hard enough to fight these temptations without making things convenient by having a friend, a wickedly subtle friend who encourages you in the wrong way. Proverbs chapter 6. Under Proverbs 6. Verse 24. Start verse 23. For the commandment is a lamp, and the law is light, and reproofs of instruction are the way of life, to keep thee from the evil woman, from the flattery of the tongue of a strange woman. Lust not after her beauty in thine heart, neither let her take thee with thine eyelids, for by means of a whorish woman a man is brought to a piece of bread, and the adulteress will hunt for the precious life. So men, and we don't have many in here who aren't married, but we have, I say, eight would be the only one approaching that age, but we have several young boys here who, Lord willing, will someday get married. So parents, when it comes to dating, make sure that whoever your children are thinking about, make sure in the early stages that your son is desiring to have a relationship with a godly young lady who dresses modestly, desires to serve God with her life. Physical attraction is a hard enough battle to fight without adding a girlfriend who wants to flaunt her body, without having a girlfriend who is flirtatious, is provocative. It's a girlfriend, a boyfriend can be this friend that will destroy your life. So we see defilement, deceit, defilement. So he starts off, he tricks her, he tricks his father, he lies about being sick. She comes in, he commits his action. Turn back to 2 Samuel 13. Third thing that we see in Amnon's life, because of Jonadab's influence, is disgust. Verses 15 through 17. Then Amnon hated her exceedingly, so that the hatred wherewith he hated her was greater than the love wherewith he had loved her. And Amnon said unto her, arise, be gone. And she said unto him, there is no cause. This evil in sending me away is greater than the other that thou didst unto me. But he would not hearken unto her. And he called his servant that ministered unto him, said, put now this woman out from me, and bolt the door after her. The Bible says that Amnon hated Tamar after he committed this sin with her. Why? Seems kind of strange. He wants his sister so bad. He loves her. He thinks she's beautiful. And then he hates her now after the this done the right way. And it might seem strange in our minds to think of him marrying his half-sister, but back in, Bible times, it wasn't as big a deal as it is now. Cain and Abel would have had to marry their sisters. There's just no other way around it. So this wasn't as big a deal. But she's saying, why don't we do this the right way? Talk to David. Nope, he didn't want anything to do with it. His motivation for this relationship was purely pleasure-based. And after he discovered the fleeting pleasure that his sin brought, he despised his sister. So ladies, talk to the men here. Men don't want to associate with girls who are provocative, who flaunt their bodies, who are froward. But ladies should beware of guys who desire to start a relationship based upon wrong motives. If a man's desire is anything less than to treat a girl in the highest biblical manner and build a relationship upon God's word, you better watch out. Don't quickly accept a person at face value. Many times people have ulterior motives for the front that they put on, and the type of guy that would take advantage of a young lady does not really look her. You see this everywhere in our world. One week, there's a girl that came here to youth group for a while, and man, her father, she would tell us. She would tell us, and she hated it. You could tell. You could tell she hated it. She would talk about her dad, and you would see her dad around town. Woman after woman after woman after woman. I mean, we're talking months. I mean, it was just over and over again. Every time you saw him, it seemed he was with a different woman. And she just despised, my dad's new girlfriend, my dad's new girlfriend. He doesn't love those people. He doesn't love those women. And yet, person after person, woman after woman falls for it. And he has money. He buys them things. And he doesn't love with a biblical love. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15:33 that evil communications corrupt good manners. So we see deception, deceit. Second thing was, I'm going to forget. Defilement, that's it. Defilement. Third thing is disgust. And the last thing is destruction. We're going to read several more verses here. Verses 22 down through 33. And it says, and Absalom spake unto his brother Amnon, neither good nor bad. It's like he's sitting clear of him. Because if he starts talking, he's just going to get angry. For Absalom hated Amnon because he forced his sister Tamar. And it came to pass after 2 years. So 2 years Absalom keeps this inside. All right, it's not right what Absalom does here. But it shows the consequences of sin. The consequences of a subtle friend. And it came to pass after 2 full years that Absalom had sheep shearers in Baal Hazor, which is beside Ephraim. And Absalom invited all the king's sons, Amnon included. And Absalom came to the king and said, behold, now thy servant hath sheep shearers. Let the king, I beseech thee, and his servants go with thy servant. And the king said to Absalom, nay, my son, let us not all now go, lest we be chargeable unto thee. And he pressed him, albeit he would not go, but blessed him. And said Absalom, if not, I pray thee, let my brother Amnon go with us. And the king said unto him, why should he go with thee? But Absalom pressed him that he let Amnon and all the king's sons go with him. Now Absalom had commanded his servants, saying, mark ye now, when Amnon's heart is merry with wine, and when I say unto you, smite Amnon, then kill him. Fear not, have not I commanded you? Be courageous and be valiant. And the servants of Absalom did unto Amnon as Absalom had commanded. Then all the king's sons arose, and every man gat him upon his mule and fled. And it came to pass, while they were in the way, that tidings came to David, saying, Absalom hath slain all the king's sons, and there is not one of them left. But that wasn't true. It shows humans' tendency to exaggerate. Then the king arose and tore his garments and lay on the earth, and all his servants stood by with their clothes rent. And Jonadab, oh look, he shows back up. Remember good old buddy Jonadab that encouraged Amnon? by the appointment of Absalom, this hath been determined from the day that he forced his sister Tamar. Now therefore let not my lord the king take the thing to his heart, to think that all the king's sons are dead, for Amnon only is dead. Some concerned friend, some concerned family member, he's a cousin. He's more than a friend, he's a cousin, he's family. And here, oh, it's okay, king. It's just Amnon. Not all the king's sons are dead, which, I mean, okay, yeah, there's a bright spot there, but this same one that encouraged him to do wrong, encouraged him to force his sister Tamar, is now, it's okay, king. It's just Amnon. He shows his true colors. The whole issue. So the last thing, did I mention? The last thing is destruction. The last thing we see in Amnon's life because of Jonadab's influence. This whole issue started with Jonadab's influence on Amnon. He was not careful concerning who his friends were. But he had a friend named Jonadab. And Jonadab was a very subtle man. His subtle words to Amnon ultimately ended in Amnon's destruction. So as we think about this, who maybe you don't have them. I'm not assuming that we all have wicked friends in here, but as a reminder, especially with children, you've got to protect. I remember my parents growing up, they would, on occasion, I don't want you hanging around this kid. I was in Christian school. A good Christian school. And they say, I don't want you hanging around this kid. I don't want you being with him. We've got to protect our kids from friends who would encourage in the wrong way. One of those boys that my parents told me not to hang around is now, I mean, yeah, kid out of wedlock. And last I knew, I saw pictures of him being baptized in some Presbyterian church. Or something like that, and he lived a rotten life, and praise the Lord for discerning parents, because if he would influence me, who knows? Who knows where I'd be? So who is the Jonadab in your life, or who is it in your children's life, or who could it be, who will it be? Is that friend who likes to undermine or question and gossip about authority? Is it a boyfriend or girlfriend, or will it be? We've got to be careful. It was less than ideal when it comes to spirituality. Maybe you're one who easily makes friends with anybody and everybody you meet. Some kids are like that. They're just, I was never like that. Some kids just can befriend anybody. Grant Kelly is like, he can talk to a total stranger like he's known his whole life. I'm not that way. Alright? But some people really are the same grace. I'm discerning when it comes to friends. But some people just gravitate to everybody, which can be scary. Beware of who you quickly befriend, lest they drag you down. Subtle changes to your character. So how do we know that friends are the type, that your friends will be the type not to contribute to the degradation of your spirituality? How do we choose direct friends? Turn to Proverbs again. Proverbs, there's several verses here we'll look at, and then we'll be done. Proverbs chapter 17. Verse 17, a friend loveth, with biblical love, by the way, not the world's definition, a friend loveth at all times. Proverbs 27, verse 6. Notice it said at all times, not in good times. 27, verse 6, faithful are the wounds of a friend. Kisses of an enemy are deceitful. There we have that word deceit again. Faithful are the wounds of a friend. This verse means that, you know what? A friend might confront you on something that you're not going to like to hear. They're going to confront you with the sin problem in your life. They're going to warn you about something. It's going to hurt. But that friend is doing you good. In the next verse we look at, just down the chapter here, verse 17, iron sharpeneth iron, so a man sharpeneth the countenance of his friend. Biblical, godly friends become better, to become more like Christ. They should love at all times, hard times, easy times, no matter what. They should encourage to become more like Christ. Not, hey, come over here, let's try this out. Have you ever smoked something before? Have you ever drank this before? Have you ever, been alone with a girl before? Have you ever tried this? These are wrong friends, wicked friends. A godly friend is going to reprove you when he sees a problem. John 15, verse 13. Destroyed Tamar's life. The Bible says she went to Absalom's house and remained desolate.